that is a key priority moving forward, and I can keep the member updated about that progress.
Thank you. That ends the statement by Shona Robinson on NHS Grampian Healthcare Improvement Scotland reports. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 11763 in the name of Mary Fee on private sector rent reform. Members who wish to take part in this debate should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Mary Fee to speak to move the motion. Ms Fee, 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In opening for Scottish Labour, I want to put on record our party's support for Shelter Scotland's Making Renting Right campaign. Shelter Scotland, as always, are at the heart of putting forward proposals on what is best for Scotland's residents. This campaign, amongst others, best exemplifies why shelter are important to our housing sector in Scotland, as their proposals come from the experience of its users. Much of what is requested by shelter was also put forward by Labour in the recent housing bill. However, the Scottish Government blocked our amendments. A consultation asking for views on a tenancy for the private rented sector has been launched, and yesterday Scottish Labour submitted our response. Will a bill follow the consultation, and can the Minister tell the Chamber the timetable of that bill? We support many of the proposals put forward by the Scottish Government. For others, we feel they could go further. For example, we believe that the minimum duration of a new tenancy should be 3 years, unless requested to be shorter, specifically by the tenant. And we also believe that a 28-day period for repossession may be too short in some circumstances. It's important to consider why Scottish Labour has brought this debate to the Chamber today. The private rented sector in Scotland is broken and in need of reform. Over the last 10 years, the number of tenants in the private rented sector has doubled. The gap between private and social rents in Scotland is the second highest in the UK. And private tenants are spending more of their income on housing compared to a decade ago. So with that in mind, let's assess what the Scottish Government has achieved. Housing bills that fail to address new and existing pressure in the private rented sector. Fewer houses built than at any point since 1947. And an expert working group that reported on what could happen with a yes vote, with no ambition set for Scotland's place in the United Kingdom. That being said, we do hope for a consensual debate this afternoon, given that many government backbenchers have signed up to support the shelter campaign. And as I have repeated many times, and will continue to do so many more times, the Housing Act of 2014 was a missed opportunity. And whilst there were aspects of the bill where Labour agreed with the SNP Government, we remain disappointed that the Scottish Government and its backbenchers voted against our amendments, which would have made a real difference to tenants in the private rented sector. Presiding Officer, the Making Renting Right campaign calls on the private rented sector to offer stability, flexibility and fairness to its tenants by modernising tenancies. This can only be achieved with the full support of this chamber and indeed through the political will of this government. A modern tenancy must strike the right balance between tenants' and landlords' rights. And in our consultation response, we stress that the tenant must have the utmost protection from unnecessary evictions, poor security, and unfair rent rises, while the landlord has a right to see returns from their investment in their property. I recognise there are many exemplary landlords. We do not seek to punish landlords, as many of our proposals will not apply to them. That is why Scottish Labour believe the proposals we put forward in the Housing Bill and to the private rented sector consultation can standardise the protection for all tenants and their families. We know that a quarter of Scots living in poverty do so as private renters, and that almost half of private rented sector households are families with children. Supporting a cap on rent rises was the sensible and practical option for the Minister and her government earlier this year. However, since new figures have shown an average rent rise of 2.7% across Scotland and higher increases in different regions, I hope the Minister will see the error of her judgment and act sooner rather than later. This is not just an English or a London problem, as the Scottish Government would like us to believe. For example, in Aberdeen City and Shire, average monthly rents have increased by almost two-fifths since 2010. And in the Lothians, private rents have increased by 17% over the last 4 years. The cost of such increases pushes more families and tenants into poverty, while the SNP refuse to take action. The average monthly cost for a two-bedroomed property in Aberdeen is £898, while the Scottish average is £537. There is a clear postcode lottery here. In June, an Ipsos Murray poll on behalf of the Chartered Institute of Housing showed us that 4 in 10 private renters worry about meeting rent payments, and 43% expressed concerns about not affording their rent in 12 months. A cap on rent rises to one per year would allow tenants to manage their finances much better and also allow landlords to plan for investment while maintaining the tenancy. And let me be clear, Scottish Labour does not back rent control, nor are we advocating rent control. Presiding officer, living with a disability can present many challenges, and one challenge that often goes unmentioned is access to suitable housing, especially within the private rented sector. As more people turn to private rented housing as a result of growing waiting lists for social housing, those with disabilities also find themselves looking to private lets. Recent statistics from the Scottish Housing Regulator shows the average number of days for social landlords to complete adaptations for medical reasons is 66 days, and in some cases, social tenants are waiting almost a year for such adaptations to be completed. This is shameful and backs up what the Leonard Cheshire Disability warned us about in their briefing ahead of today's debate. It is often expected that social landlords have the resources available to meet demands for repairs and adaptations that private landlords can't compete with. So with no statistics available for comparison, I have to share my support for the changes Leonard Cheshire would like to occur, as I worry that many disabled people in private housing are not having their needs met. There are means of financial support where grants can be applied for. However, with pressure on local government, the demand is not matched by supply. Leonard Cheshire says in their briefing why disabled-friendly homes are more cost-effective in the long term. For example, the cost of installing a stair lift in lifetime homes costs around £2,500. However, if the wall is not suitable for stair lifts, then the cost to adapt this could exceed 5 or 10 times the original cost of the lift. Building homes that meet the needs of the elderly and disabled requires commitment from government and developers, and without this, the standards cannot be met. Presiding officer, I talked a few minutes ago about the worries about meeting rent payments, and it cannot be overemphasised the stress on finance, health and mental well-being caused through lack of security. Children can suffer in education if they have to relocate every year or two. Research suggests that anxiety and stress can develop with children because of the stress of moving. The average length of time spent by a family at the same address in the private rented sector is 2 to 3 years, compared to 10 years in the social rented sector. Modernising the tenancy by scrapping the short Scottish secure tenancy, creating greater security of tenure and introducing an annual cap of rent increases will help mitigate and tackle many of the direct and indirect problems resulting from lack of security.
You draw to a close, please.
In closing, Presiding Officer, our motion does not seek to create division between members of this chamber. It highlights the need for change in how the private rented sector works. The number of private tenants has doubled in a decade, as have the number of households living in poverty in the private rented sector. Across the chamber, I hope we can all agree we want a well-regulated, stable private rented sector. I move the motion in my name.
Many thanks. We have absolutely no spare time at all this afternoon, so I now call on Minister Margaret Burgess to speak to and move Amendment 11763.3. Minister, up to 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm glad to have this opportunity to debate the private rented sector. The growth of the sector may be news to some in this chamber, but the Scottish Government identified it as an issue as far back as 2010, as we recognised that an increasing number of people, including families, were spending part of their housing journey in the sector. At that point, we committed to developing a strategy for the private rented sector and set out to do so working with a Scottish Private Rented Sector Strategy Group, which comprised stakeholders representing tenants, landlords and others with interests in the sector. The result was the first ever strategy for the sector in Scotland, which we published in May 2013. The strategy set out our vision for the sector and identified three aims: improving quality, delivering for tenants and landlords, and enabling growth and investment to help increase overall housing supply. In these aims, we recognise that the private rented sector plays a valuable part in meeting housing need for many people, but also that more could be done to make it more attractive to those who, for a range of reasons, prefer not to buy. We have made good progress in taking forward the strategy. The Housing Act that Parliament passed in June will improve quality through a regulatory framework for letting agents and additional powers for local authorities to deal with poor landlords. And the consultation on a new tenancy for the private rented sector that I launched in October sets out proposals to give tenants improved security of tenure. I'll take an intervention.
Mr. Kelly.
Thank the Minister for taking an intervention. She tells the Chamber that the Government have made good progress in relation to issues in the private rented sector. Can she perhaps tell us then why there was nothing in the legislative programme to address the issues of rent rises and lack of security of tenure?
Minister.
I say to the member that we had the strategy group which consulted and met together, and that at that point was not recognised as an issue. It was not part of our bill when it was introduced, nor was it introduced by any of the consultation. It didn't come up in the consultation, nor by the Labour Party during our consultation. What we did commit to do was consult on a new tenancy for the private rented sector, and that's the right way to do it, and that's what we're doing. And we're currently consulting on that, and we want to ensure that that provides safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors, as well as security for tenants. And I'm pleased that Shelter welcomes our ambition for changes in the sector. And I want to confirm to Shelter and to the other stakeholders that this Government remains committed to passing in this parliamentary session the legislation necessary to establish a new tenancy regime for the private rented sector. And we'll say more about that in spring next year once we've considered the responses to the consultation. The Scottish Government is also supporting Homes for Scotland in its work to drive forward initiatives to build more homes for rent by attracting new sources of investment. And as part of that commitment, we've funded the appointment of a private rented sector champion to lead in this. But in the context of this afternoon's debate, increasing supply is particularly relevant. Where rents are high, the long-term answer is more supply in every tenure to meet growing demand.
And I recognise that rents are indeed high in some hotspots across the country. And where this is the case, it reflects conditions in local housing markets. But statistics published by the Scottish Government last month showed wide variations in average rents. For example, average monthly rents for two-bedroom properties range from less than £450 a month in Dumfries and Galloway to almost twice that in Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire. Likewise, increases in rents also vary. But our statistics show that between 2010 and 2014, most average rents increased below the rate of inflation, with some rents actually falling. In particular, a total of 16 out of the 18 rental market areas across Scotland have seen below inflation changes in average rents for two-bedroom properties, the most common size of property in the private rented sector. And the exceptions to this, if it's brief, Presiding Officer.
James Kelly, briefly.
In terms of rent levels, I think you've been listening too much to the letting agents saying that they've been below the rate of inflation. Do you think the average level of monthly rent of £537 a month, do you think that's acceptable?
What I would say to the member, we weren't listening to letting agents to get that information. That is Scottish Government research, and that research shows quite clearly that 16 out of the 18 rental markets area have seen below inflation changes in average rents. And as I say, where rents are higher rising, the answer is to build more houses, not just for private renting, but in all tenures, and we've taken decisive action in this. And to take the particular case of Aberdeen, we recognise that funding affordable housing there has been causing difficulties in the recruitment and retention of key staff in the NHS and other parts of the public sector. These workers are now set to benefit from various forms of affordable housing that will be developed on the Craiginch site in the city, and importantly targeted at these key workers. And in terms of supply generally, we've boosted housing supply budgets by investing £1.7 billion in affordable housing in the lifetime of this Parliament. And last month, we announced a £200 million increase in funding to stimulate Scotland's housing industry. Presiding Officer, despite challenging economic conditions and Scottish budgets being cut, our rate of house building per head continues to outperform other parts of the UK. We've delivered over 22,700 affordable homes, three quarters of the way towards our 30,000 affordable homes target. Over 15,900 of these are for social rent, which is 80% of our social rent target. And I would remind the Chamber that in the last 4 years of the previous administration, just over 20,000 affordable homes were completed. In the following 4 years, we increased this by 34%. In fact, there was not one single year during this period when this government didn't complete more homes. So, Presiding Officer, this Scottish Government is working with our stakeholders to deliver better quality and more security in the private rented sector, and to deliver the variety and number of affordable homes that are the answer to high rents in the sector. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. Now call on Alex Johnston. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Johnston.
Presiding Officer, can I take the opportunity to move the amendment in my name? And also, however, welcome the motion in the name of Mary Fee, because it gives us an opportunity to address something which is the centre of discussion within the private rented sector, and that is the party's various positions around rent controls. Now, I hear what has been said in the opening speech, that the Labour Party apparently are not in favour of rent controls, but I also hear that they are in favour of annual limits on rent increases, and I'm beginning to have some difficulty in understanding what is meant by rent control if we are going to have one of these things and not the other. However, when it comes to housing, it's sometimes said that there's nothing new under the sun, and rent control, of course, is something which has been tried often enough before. It was first introduced in the UK in 1915, and maybe the opportunity exists next year for us to celebrate its 100th birthday by burying it deeply in our history. Any student of housing policy history will recognise that the 1915 rent controls had a catastrophic effect. The number of houses to rent in the private sector collapsed dramatically as landlords sold off their stock, and investment and improvements also fell. The reintroduction today could also make it more difficult for landlords to access finance, as lenders may be nervous of future interest rate increases against a backdrop of severely limited rent increases. This was not the only time rent controls have been attempted in this country, of course. They did return during the Second World War with significant effects. And I think it's important that we do not make the mistake, whoever we are, of going forward with a third-time lucky approach and our fingers crossed. Although rent controls were abandoned in the UK many years ago, various forms of them continued in many places across Europe. But in these examples, the effect of rent controls actually keeps them at or around market levels. It may be, then, that introducing rent control of that kind could either result in the negative impacts I described earlier, or actually have little or no impact on rent levels if the Scottish Government chooses to follow that European model. Of course, it no longer surprises me that Labour, bereft of their own ideas, appear to use the position of shelter as a default setting for their housing policy. But having discussed the private rented sector with shelter, it seems obvious to me that they enjoy a much more sophisticated and realistic understanding of the issues than perhaps some in this chamber do. The position is, very briefly,
James Kelly.
Just in terms of a realistic understanding of the housing situation, do you recognise that one in four of those living in the private rented sector are living in poverty? And what are the Conservatives offering in terms of help to those who need much needed assistance?
James Kelly. I think what we have to be careful of is using inappropriate statistics. Now, we've already heard one set of statistics balanced with the government statistics in the two opening speeches. I could also say that far from showing that tenants in the Scottish private sector are concerned about escalating rent levels, a recent poll found that 86% of tenants surveyed had never received a request for a rent increase during their lease. 90% had never experienced a rent rise that was deemed to be unreasonable. 91% of tenants think that the frequency of rent reviews on their property has been reasonable. I think these statistics demonstrate that, unlike the claim that was made by the Labour Party earlier in this debate, the system is not broken. And if we do this correctly, we can continue to rely on the private rented sector to make their contribution to the housing problems we have in Scotland today. Recently, I met with representatives. I've met a lot of representatives of the private rented sector, all of whom are open to working in a constructive manner with the Scottish Government to improve the industry. They are ready to engage, but they are also deeply concerned at the impact that some of these proposals might have. The private rented sector is playing an increasingly important role in accommodating home seekers at a time when the private sector is picking up the slack from the lack of investment in affordable housing by successive governments, current and their predecessors. For that reason, I think it is essential that we take a constructive and engaged approach, a measured approach, and one that does not have the negative impact on the private rented sector, which all of us would regret should it happen.
Many thanks. And we now move to the open debate, and I call on John Mason to be followed by Ken McIntosh. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Clearly, the private rented sector is changing and growing, and we need to keep legislation up to speed with these changes. In a constituency like mine in Glasgow-Shettleston, there was a huge number of council or housing association houses and a fair number of owner-occupiers, and also a traditional private rented sector. But that has changed hugely now, especially through right to buy, and previous council or housing association properties, as well as bought houses, now having moved into the private rented sector. It seems to me there's a number of reasons why people use a private rent. One is younger people who just want it for the very short term, and I, and I'm sure other members, have been in that situation. Two, they cannot get affordable housing, so they are forced unwillingly into the private rented sector. Now, the answer to that has been to end right to buy, which has been absolutely correct, and over time, hopefully, to build more affordable homes. But thirdly, there are those who can't or don't want to buy, and private rent is their preferred route for the long term. I think this is much more common in other countries and seems to be becoming more common here now. Now, quite a number of the antisocial behaviour issues I get come from private rented flats. Clearly, this can be because you will get difficult tenants, difficult residents anywhere, but I think the lack of stability for private tenancies is making things worse. If a tenancy is likely to be very short-term, where is the incentive to build up relationships with neighbours and the wider community? Where is the incentive to maintain, improve or invest in the property? And especially if improving your property means the rent goes up, as one of my colleagues told me they had experienced, that is a positive disincentive to improve it. Looking at Shelter's Making Renting Right campaign, it is very much the word stability and security which attract me. If there is a phrase in Shelter's campaign that I was less comfortable with, it would be, quote, to stay as long as they want, which came in under the flexibility heading. However, I was interested to see today that the briefing we received from Shelter today said flexibility for people to stay in their home as long as they need. And I suspect that's something that people will be more comfortable with, because I think some of Alec Johnson's chums were maybe a bit frightened off about people staying as long as they wanted. When we look at the social rented sector, we see a reasonable balance. On the one hand, there is security and stability, but on the other hand, people can be evicted if the worst comes to the worst. And I am encouraged by the positive relationship between police and housing associations who work together so that the neighbour from hell can, at the end of the day, be evicted. And we would certainly want to see that as well in the private rented sector. Now, the Minister and members may not be surprised that as we are debating housing today, I did want to mention the Belgrove Hotel in my constituency. This is privately owned and the residents are renting, although I accept it may not be typical of what Mary Fee is talking about today. But I think one of the lessons from the Belgrove Hotel, which is effectively a hostel, it may have for all of us today is the condition of private rented accommodation, which is another factor in all of this. If I took you into a range of tenements in Parkhead or Shettleston, you would know within seconds of entering them which were private lets and which were housing association run. Now, I do hasten to add there are some very good private rented flats, but others are pretty grim, and you see it immediately. Linked to that is electrical safety, another issue which has been raised, and the Electrical Safety First campaign on this type of issue, and I hope the government will be open to input from them going forward. So clearly there is work to be done in a changing landscape, but I think we also have to be very positive about achievements so far. Ending the right to buy has been a huge improvement. Investing in new affordable housing whenever there is spare money has been great. And initial steps to register landlords and letting agents are all very much moves in the right direction. I see I've run out of time.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much. And I appreciate your brevity. And now call on Ken McIntosh to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And in our last debate in housing, I described the difficult and anxious situation facing a resident in East Renfrewshire who had come to see me for advice and any assistance I could offer. This is a young man with two children at local schools, but whose partner had left and who could no longer afford to live in the family home. With few priority housing points, there was next to no chance of him getting a council or housing association property on the Eastwood side of the authority. And although he has worked all his life, in fact, a mortgage in this area was also well out of his reach. Now, I'm pleased to tell you that along with his children, he has now found a private rented flat on the south side of Glasgow, close enough to get the bus up to school and, more importantly, just about affordable. How many cases have we all heard about over the last few years, some with far less satisfactory outcomes? Presiding Officer, problems with housing supply are helping to drive huge changes to the way we live in Scotland. We're simply not building enough homes. The number of new private homes has more than halved in recent years, while the population is increasing. In terms of council or housing association property, Audit Scotland have identified a shortfall of almost 14,000 homes in the last decade alone, and there are up to a dozen local authorities in the same situation as East Renfrewshire, where the waiting list for a council house has increased over the last 5 years. An estimated 150,000 people find themselves in this predicament in Scotland. The fact that the number of Scots now living in private rented accommodation has doubled over the last decade demonstrates precisely how important this sector has become. My constituent and his family landed on their feet, but for many more families, moving into a private let leaves them feeling insecure, or worse, it becomes a move into poverty. The Joseph Rowntree Foundation has found that private renters spend 23% of their income on housing, up from 18% just 10 years ago. And the number of families in the private rented sector on housing benefit has increased from 60,000 in 2008 to 97,000 in 2013. Last year's Scottish Household Survey highlighted the insecurity of tenure in the private rented sector compared to the alternative. The average length of time for someone in the private rented sector staying at the same address is between 2 and 3 years, compared to over 10 years in the social rented sector and 15 years at an owner-occupied home. Now, some of this, as John Mason just pointed out, may reflect choice or people in transition to home ownership. But with so many families now leasing privately, there is the danger of such instability having a detrimental effect on the more vulnerable. Presiding officer, there's not one solution to Scotland's housing problems, and we clearly need to build more homes. But reform of the private rented sector should at least be part of the way forward. At the moment, many people are fearful of moving into a private let, but are forced by circumstance to do so. The constituency case that I gave as an example is far from unique, but as I'm sure most colleagues recognise, for the majority of constituents, renting privately is their least favoured option. Similarly, many landlords are increasingly wary of renting to bad tenants who they then can't get rid of. Now, I don't believe this is a sustainable way on which the sector can develop. Shelter's campaign to make renting right could help both tenants and landlords. It could provide stability and security for both and introduce a fairer system for resolving problems where they occur. There are plenty of examples in Europe where private renting is seen as safe, affordable and a desirable option. Here in Scotland, on the other hand, the gap between the tenancy regime for private and public landlords simply aggravates the sense of inequality created by the difference in rent levels between the two. According to the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, the average private rent is 86% higher than the average social rent in this country. This is not an anti-landlord measure. Shelter have shown the way forward. Labour have put this into parliamentary practice, and I urge members from all sides to support our motion.
Thank you very much. I now call on Claire Adamson to be followed by Siobhan McMahon. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by picking up on some of the comments by my colleague John Mason with regards to the quality of tenancies? I chair the cross-party group on accident prevention and safety awareness, and we are very aware of some of the dangers that are in the home, and have covered this issue on many occasions. Indeed, our last meeting was about the challenges of electrical and gas safety and the responsibility for landlords. This was a very informative meeting. We had presentations from Select, from Electrical Safety First, of course, formerly the Electrical Safety Council, and also from SGN on the gas issues. All of these organisations provide guides to landlords and to tenants and information, and these presentations are available on the ROSPA website, and I would commend them to members who have tenants who have concerns at this stage. I can also say that I'll be welcoming an update of the electrical guidelines following the amendments that were passed, championed by my colleague Bob Doris, in terms of tightening up some of the issues around electrical safety. And I would welcome any further information that the government may have on tightening up on regulation of electricians in Scotland going forward. I have to take issue slightly with it. Well, this is a very good debate to be having this afternoon, and we all recognise that there's more we could be doing in Scotland. I did take issue with Mary Fee saying that this is a government that hasn't taken action. I think this is a government who has acted very responsibly in the area of housing. We've had action on affordable homes. We've had actions on tackling the problems in the private sector, as just outlined. We've had actions on... Yes, certainly.
Mary Fee.
It's just on the point when you say the government's acted responsibly. Would a responsible government be in a position where the record on building affordable homes or building housing is the lowest since the Second World War? Is that responsible?
Well, perhaps I could just remind Mary Fee of the Labour and Liberal Democrats' record in this area. According to the Housing Statistics for Scotland 2014 Key Trends Summary, published by the government, it shows that on average, every year, when you look at housing association, local authority build, rehabilitation and conversion, the record of your former government was to build an average of 5,856 houses. The average of this government under austerity with our capital budget slashed is 6,193 houses. And in local authority levels, on average, 43 from the Labour and the Dems, this government 658. I think that is a responsible government taking action and actually being responsible about housing in Scotland. They've also taken action in the... We've taken action in the tenancy deposit schemes. We've launched the consultation on tenancy, which will gather the information relevant to Scotland that will allow us to take forward a tenancy bill that will be relevant to what's happening in Scotland. And we also took action on the right to buy, transformational for the opportunities for local authorities to build housing, taking action on landlord registration, and tackling supply with innovation, as announced by the Cabinet Secretary this morning, where they will be using the charitable bond model to put a further £25 million next year into that could lead to 450 additional affordable homes in Scotland. Alex Neil said today, in a fair society, just society, we want to make sure that everyone in Scotland has access to good quality housing that meets their needs. I am very glad that this government is taking that forward.
Many thanks. And I now call on Siobhan McMahon to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to take part in this afternoon's debate and highlight just one of the issues being faced by my constituents with regards to housing. I was contacted some months ago by my constituent who works as a porter within the NHS. My constituent has been forced to take a private rented flat after his long-term relationship broke up. As a result, he now finds that his NHS wage only meets his rent and household bills. His situation is so bad that he has had to go to his parents every night for his evening meal. This man is in his 40s and has worked his entire adult life, and he can't afford his rent. This is nothing short of scandalous, and it is one of the many reasons that I'm supporting Shelters Making Renting Right campaign. I'm particularly pleased to support Shelters' call for more flexibility with regards to the tenancy agreement. As Shelters state, the private rented sector is changing. Current demand suggests that while some people want the option of a tenancy that lasts for as long as they need it, others want flexibility if they need to move. We want a tenancy regime that can respond to people's needs and work for both landlords and tenants. For tenants, it is about striking the balance between being able to live as long as they need in a property, with due consideration given to the landlord in terms of adequate notice when they want to leave. I believe that this is a practical measure which will not only benefit tenants, but will benefit landlords too. By offering an agreement which benefits both parties, greater trust and commitment will be established, and as a result, there will be a greater belief in the system, something that is missing from the agreement now. We need to take action now on the spiraling cost of private rent. It is simply not good enough that hard-working people are finding that they have no other choice than to get themselves into huge amounts of debt simply to keep a roof over their heads. Given that 13% of housing stock is in the private rented sector and that 1 in 4 private rented households have children, we need to address the massive problem in this sector quickly. It must be a priority for the government and for this parliament. Only a few weeks ago, I asked the Minister a very straightforward question in this chamber. I asked her if she supported Shelters' campaign or not. It was a simple yes-no answer. However, I got neither in return. I hope that she will now be definite in her answer today and once and for all pledge her support for the campaign and confirm what action she will now take, given that the government have known about this problem, in her own words, since 2010. To hear that the number of people living in poverty in the private rented sector has doubled in the last decade should make all politicians extremely uncomfortable. That is why we need action now, and that is why I ask the Minister not only to support Shelter Scotland's campaign, but also back Scottish Labour's proposals to introduce a specific bill on the private rented sector. We want to see a bill introduced to provide people with greater security with regards to the tenure, and importantly, we wish to see a cap on rent rises. I believe that this would make a huge difference to tenants' lives, and it is something that could be legislated on quickly. I hope that the Minister will now back our proposals. On a separate note, I was delighted that the Smith Commission have suggested that our Parliament receive the power to legislate in relation to socio-economic areas. I hope that that will mean establishing an equality impact assessment in this area. This is something I call for in my own submission to the Commission. I believe that this power would allow the government to truly assess if their policies are making the difference they would like to see in reducing poverty in our communities. I believe that this will be particularly useful in assessing just how effective the Scottish Government's policy on housing and housing stock has been in reducing inequalities in Scotland. I hope that the Minister is listening to the request being made to her today and she finds a way to address the concerns of members, charities, campaigners and, most importantly, tenants, as they need action now, not more war on words. Thank you.
Thanks. And I call on George Adam to be followed by Patrick Harvey. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome this debate because it's a very important and basic need, and it's an issue that I believe the Scottish Government takes very seriously. As other members have already mentioned, it is a major issue within all of our constituencies with some of the cases that we could deal with on a day-to-day basis. But within my constituency, there is proof of the Scottish Government's investment in private and social housing currently being built right smack in the centre of town. Not a case of our Scottish Government refusing to take action. These homes are right in the heart of town and not only creating homes for families but also helping to regenerate the town centre as we look at the many challenges that town centres like Paisley have at the moment. There are many challenges regarding the private rented sector, but for me the main solution, and the one that I believe the Scottish Government are taking, is to go down the route of affordable housing. As the Minister has already stated, the Scottish Government plans to spend over £1.7 billion over the lifetime of this Parliament on affordable housing. But this is part of an ongoing, bold and ambitious plan for housing. In 2015-16, £390 million will be invested to deliver, unfortunately I've only got a short time, Mr Findlay, to deliver 6,000 more affordable homes. 4,000 will be in social rented area, and this is the type that are making a major difference in our constituencies. It appears that even though I said no to Mr Findlay, he still wants to actually shout from afar. But this happens across the whole country. But this is a very important issue and one we should be taking seriously and not bringing the Chamber into disrepute. The Council housing of £135 million has been spent by the Scottish Government since 2009, and housing is a main priority of the Scottish Government. But I am aware the Scottish Government is making steps to realise their vision in the private rented sector and dealing with the many issues. And one of these is obviously mentioned by the Government is the fact that the strategy the Government has already set out for the private sector. And these will help many of our constituents to improve the quality of property management, condition and service, to deliver for tenants and landlords and meeting the needs of people living. Unfortunately, I am running out of time, and the more intervention we seem to get, I seem to kind of lose more of my time. But this issue we have to take. If the Presiding Officer, if the Labour Party actually believed in doing something for some of the constituents in my area, like Mr Bibby, if they truly believed in that, they would have taken more than a short last-minute debate in housing. They would have taken their full time for it. Because this issue affects every single one of our constituents. And I am not going to listen to members of the Labour Party just showboating when we're dealing with people's lives. Because these are the people that we represent, these are the people that we have to make sure we can make the difference. This isn't just about politics, this is about the basic need of people getting a home, a roof over their head, and ensuring that we can debate this in a mature manner. And I would urge the Labour Party to become serious about these issues and not just sit here and play some political game, like a game of tennis going back and forward. But, Presiding Officer, I've already stated that the housing is a very basic need. It's also an extremely complex and challenging issue. I appreciate the work and the ongoing vision of the Scottish Government, and I'm only too aware that the differences that their policies are making in constituencies all like ours throughout the country. And it's time for everyone else within this chamber to actually look at this debate, take it very seriously and start representing our constituents.
Many thanks. Appreciate your brevity. Colin Patrick Harvey to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Labour Party for bringing this debate, which, to be fair, is by no means the first debate that opposition parties have brought on the issue of housing during the current session. In those debates, I've argued repeatedly that we can't afford to treat housing as just like any other commercial transaction. Housing is different. Housing is intimate. It impacts on our health, physical and mental, on our access to friends, to family, to neighbours, our ability to live as part of a community. It impacts on our access to employment and public services. It impacts on our dignity and our very identity. Not just because of the nature of housing, being something beyond other kinds of commercial transactions, but also because of the lack of availability and choices that people have, as John Mason referred to earlier. So many people in our society now no longer have availability of social rented housing and no longer can find it affordable for many of them at any point in their lives to become owner-occupiers. Private rented housing is the only housing that our society is making available to them for large parts of their lives. That means that we need to take it seriously. That means we need to recognise that this is social provision and regulate it as such. Expect that of it. Mary Fee says that there are many exemplary landlords out there, and I suspect everybody would recognise that there is a wide spectrum of experience that tenants have from the private rented sector, from exemplary landlords to quite the opposite. There are those who recognise that providing housing is something significant, is something meaningful, and that if you charge for rent more than you are paying to service the debt that's secured on a property, that profit you are making needs to be earned. Being a landlord is doing a job. There are landlords who understand that and who have pride in providing a decent service, a decent standard of service, and making sure that their tenants are well looked after. There are also landlords who simply think it's a sense of entitlement to rake in the profit. Both parts of that spectrum are there, and there are all forms of behaviour that we can see. It's not enough simply to say that more people are going to be in that sector. The sector has doubled in 10 years and wants to double again. It's not enough simply to say that's going to be part of the mix, and so we have to support all landlords. We should support good landlords, and good landlords who provide a standard of service that they should be proud of will have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear from imposing a decent regulatory expectation on the sector. Margaret Burgess recognised in her speech that many families, I think she said, many families spend time in the private rented sector as part of their housing journey. To where? Their housing journey to where? Just recently, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation report entitled Young Working and Renting, looking at the changing nature of poverty and inequality in this country, recognised that the number of private landlord repossessions is now higher than the number of mortgage repossessions, and at the end of a private rented tenancy is the primary reason for people becoming homeless. Now, these are UK statistics, and I would be interested to know whether the Minister can confirm whether these are true at Scottish level as well. In closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, can I finally have a note of caution about a word we heard from Mr Johnson? Home seekers. Home seekers. Surely we've already seen the euphemism of terms like job seekers instead of unemployment. Let's not make the same mistake and talk of home seekers instead of recognising that the reality of homelessness is something very significant in our society.
Thanks so much. And I now call Richard Lyle, after which we move to closing speeches.
Thank you, President. Officer, can I compliment Mary Fee on with her sore voice, and I hope it gets better. I read over the Labour Party's motion with interest. I must say it was indeed interesting to see that it stated the Labour Party believes that the private rented sector tenancies should be reformed to provide tenants with greater security of tenure. Well, this is an area where I understand this government is taking the action to improve. They're already doing it. Members may have read, as I did, the private rented sector tenancy review group report. This is a report of the private rented sector strategy group, a group set up by the Scottish Government in 2013 with a purpose to examine how suitable and effective the current private rented sector system was, and crucially to consider whether changes in the law were needed. It will be interesting to a Labour Party that I noted the Scottish Government did indeed accept the main recommendations of the report of the group, which was the current tenancies for the private sector, the assured tenancy, and short assured tenancy be replaced by a new tenancy for all future lets. The government published this draft consultation. No, I've only got 4 minutes. Thanks. Into this proposed new type of tenancy for the private rented sector, and after considering the views of the people who responded to the consultation, the government, I am sure, will act accordingly. I believe the government has a track record of looking carefully at the issues facing the private rented sector. They have been clear, particularly in their strategy, a place to stay, a place to call home, regarding the private rented sector. They've set out a vision, the strategic aims for the private rented sector, with clear aims to improve and grow the private rented sector by enabling a more effective regulatory system, targeting tougher enforcement action and attracting new investment. This can only improve the situation for tenants. In a nation rich in natural resources like ours, it's simply and utterly a scandal that people are living in poverty. This is mainly, and I would suggest, due to the UK government benefit cuts and austerity measures, which are increasingly hurting Scottish families. We're also now seeing an increase in the use of food banks. I believe the Scottish Government is doing everything it can to help those in this situation by working with stakeholders to mitigate the worst impacts of welfare reform for those in the lowest incomes through the various measures and decisions that this Government has taken. I also note that the Government is providing nearly £33 million of support to the most vulnerable through the new Scottish Welfare Fund. Last night, Mr Finlay will find this interesting. Last night in an event, I had a very interesting discussion with an official involved in the housing sector. No, he wasn't lobbying me. He informed me that there are presently three types of renting: sociable rent, middle rent and private rent. In his opinion, the proposal made today by the Labour Party is totally unworkable and would cause many owners in the private rented sector to withdraw from that sector. This would put undue pressure on families who presently rent. Also, in an event before I came into this chamber today, I had a discussion with the representatives from GGF, informing me that the UK government is charging 20% VAT instead of 5% VAT in replacing windows. Another example of where we could improve and help fuel poverty if we were so minded to do so, and if the UK government would do so. Presiding officer, I am sure that this government is clearly committed to taking action on the issues facing the private rented sector. More and more are committed wholeheartedly to tackling poverty in Scotland and the various symptoms of poverty. And I support this amendment by the Scottish Government. Thank you.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches. And I call on Alex Johnson. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Johnson.
There's been a couple of mentions of shelters making Make Renting Right campaign and the fact that they've been asking politicians to sign up to it. I've discussed it with them. I haven't signed it yet. But to be honest, there's much in there that I do support, and I have come very close to agreeing to put my signature on that document. The strange thing is, though, if it actually turns out that what it means is what the Labour Party thinks it means, then it would be impossible for me to sign. The fact is that, as we've had demonstrated during the course of this debate, people have different opinions in different corners of this chamber, and there is a disconnect about what we're actually talking about. We heard, for example, much talked about the average rents that exist in the private sector in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire. Yet no attempt to understand that the nature of the private rented sector in the North East at the moment includes people who are extremely high earners renting extremely expensive property. The kind of property, the kind of rent certainly, that would make our eyes water in this chamber. But yet these figures are being taken into the average and misrepresented in this debate. I think it's important that we also realise that the comment that was made about many people renting as part of their housing journey is in fact the case. Many of my own family have rented in the private sector for a while in preparation for taking on a mortgage. And that happens all over the country. And they too are included in these statistics. I'm afraid I don't have the time to... I need to get to a conclusion here. What we need to understand is that the private rented sector does different things in different parts of the country. It does different things in different streets close together, and these things are not easy to compare. This is a complex marketplace, and one which some during this debate have demonstrated a much greater understanding of than others. The fact is that the private rented sector has, by accident or design, become an essential part of our housing strategies as we stand at the current moment. Yet there are those out there who are very tempted to blame the private rented sector for many of the problems that we face. I don't think that is a justified approach in every case. The last thing the industry needs is some kind of politically inspired witch hunt, similar to the one that's currently being vested on our landowners. There are, of course, aspects of the Scottish Government's proposals that are worthy of consideration and support. But the bottom line is that rent controls in any form, tinkering with the tenancies, will achieve little when the primary issue is a lack of investment by the Scottish Government into bricks and mortar. I was surprised to find myself agreeing very strongly with George Adam when he made some comments a moment ago, and that is that you cannot legislate your way out of a housing crisis. You can only build your way out of a housing crisis. More houses available for rent means that landlords in the private sector will have to compete for tenants and offer higher standards and lower rents. If we build houses, the market will deliver the changes that many of us have asked for today. Yet, at this moment, the private rented sector are plugging a gap that we cannot do without. We need the private rented sector until we reach these days when we can build adequate numbers of houses. And if we make the wrong decision, if we make the mistake of undermining the private rented sector without taking alternative action to plug the gap elsewhere, then homelessness will be the only result.
Thanks so much. I now call on Margaret Burgess. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. I think what this debate has certainly confirmed is that the growing significance of the private rented sector and the increasing role that it plays in helping meet our people's housing needs. And I would say, I think, to Siobhan McMathen, it's been mentioned a number of times about the shelter campaign. The Scottish Government has been working with shelter and other stakeholders in developing our proposals for a new private rented tenancy. And indeed, shelter's campaign, Making Renting Right, supporting the Scottish Government in making rent right across Scotland. And this is because we've already put forward, I'll take them in a moment, this is because we've put forward proposals that seek to improve the security of tenure of tenants.
I thank the Minister for taking my intervention. The question was, do you support shelter, not does shelter support you? That was the question.
Minister.
What I said is that I support the wider aims of Shelter's campaign in making rent right across Scotland, and I've never said that I didn't support that. And we're working with Shelter, but we're currently consulting just now on the proposals, and it wouldn't be appropriate for me to come down on one set of proposals against another. That's what a consultation is about. It's about talking to all those involved in the housing sector, and that's what we are doing, and that's what we consider as the right way before we change any policies in terms of the private sector. And I think when we're thinking about to do with rents, we're seeking views on rents as part of this tenancy reform in terms of our consultation, and it doesn't close till the 28th of December. So we will reflect very carefully on all the responses to the consultation before deciding on what will be in our forthcoming bill on tenancy reform. We will announce our plans in the spring of next year and hope to introduce our bill in the autumn. But I think this afternoon I've stressed, and so have many other speakers in the debate, that the best way to tackle high-level rents is... I'll take one more intervention.
Ms. Kelly.
Thank the Minister for taking the intervention. Even on the timetable that the Minister's outlined, by the time that any bill is enacted, it's going to be another 2 years before tenants in the private rented sector get any support for the issues that they face around security of tenure or rising rent levels. That is unacceptable. Does the Minister not accept that legislation should have been introduced in the programme last week?
Minister.
No, I accept that we're currently consulting and we have to take time to consult and look at the responses, and that is a proper and measured way to do it. And we did that with our stakeholders in the sector. We're aware that that was the timescale we were moving forward to. We said we'd do it within the lifetime of this Parliament, and that's what we intend to do, and that's what was said from the outset. A couple of other things that have been mentioned. Patrick Harvey talked about the housing journey. The housing journey, I want to make it clear that I was talking about, is that it's different for different people at different times in their lives, and it's not automatic that you transcend from social rent to private rent to owner-occupied. Some people will stay in one section because that's what suits them and that's what suits their needs. So it wasn't in any way suggesting it was a transitional way. In terms of the figures that Patrick Harvey asked about in terms of homelessness, I can't tell him if I have those figures, but what I can do is we will look at that, and if we record that, I will pass that information on to Patrick and to the Chamber. But as we talked about increasing supply, I would just want to remind some of the government's achievements on that score. And I'll say it again, we're building more houses in the last 7 years than any previous administration in this Scottish Parliament. In terms of social rent, in terms of housing associations, social rent and affordable housing. And we've also boosted the house building industry in a time of recession. We're on track to deliver homes, but we're also helping the house building industry with our Help to Buy scheme, which has boosted the industry and jobs. We've boosted our affordable housing supply budget over the 5 years. We've committed over £300 million to Help to Buy. We've got our National Housing Trust scheme. So we're constantly looking at ways of boosting the housing supply. And I'm also proud that we've legislated to end the right to buy. And I think John Mason mentioned that in his contribution. And we're also proud that we've provided £90 million in the period from 2013-16 to mitigate the effects of the bedroom tax. And we continue to work with partners to develop new housing investment models which are capable of attracting large-scale, long-term funding from the capital markets to expand the delivery of housing for affordable and private rent. An example of this is Hearthstone Investments plans for a £150 million fund to invest in more than 1,000 homes across Scotland, which has secured £30 million from Falkirk Council pension funds. We continue to use innovative financing approaches, such as our successful National Housing Trust, which is the first guarantee-based model for housing in the UK, which is helping hundreds of households to secure a high-quality home that meets their needs. And we continue to do this working with stakeholders, our partners, and we'll publish a joint delivery plan for housing in Scotland by the end of April 2015, following on from our housing event in November this year. And that event was unique in bringing together councils, housing associations, house builders, lenders, landlords, and many others with contributions to make to our shared ambition that everyone in Scotland has access to good quality, affordable housing that meets their needs.
Many thanks. I now call on James Kelly. Up to 8 minutes, please, Mr Kelly.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Labour Party has used its slot, not for the first time, to bring forward a debate on housing because of the important issues that are faced in the private rented sector. Because of a shortage in housing supply and a lot of people lacking the finance to be able to afford mortgages, the private rented sector has really grown, doubled in size in recent years to 368,000. The two particular problems that have been brought out in Labour's motion and also during the course of the debate are rising rent levels and security of tenure. On rents, it is a fact that rents have been going up in every region. And they now stand at the average level is £537 a month throughout Scotland. That's a staggering figure. Mr. Johnson makes the point that, you know, in regards to that, the high rent levels, rent rises in Aberdeen, that, you know, there are high earners there. What I would point out to Mr. Johnson is that, you know, if you look at what is going on in Edinburgh, where on average people are having to spend 47% of their income on rent. That shows you the sort of issues that people are having to face on the ground. You know, and I think, you know, Mr. Johnson would be able to... I'll let you in just a wee minute, Minister. I think Mr. Johnson would be able to take a walk not far from this Parliament to find out about some of the real issues that people in the private rented sector are facing.
Minister.
Except, though, that in across Scotland, that of 16 out of the 18 broad market rental areas, that the average increase has been less than inflation.
James Kelly.
I think the Minister's been listening too much to the letting agents. If you go to postcode areas in Glasgow, in Dundee, in Aberdeen and in Edinburgh, there are staggering levels of rent rises going up to the level of 40% in Aberdeen. That is unacceptable, and it is the job of government to intervene and to try and take some action on those rent levels. The other issue that has come up in the debate is obviously security of tenure. People in private rented accommodation tend to only be there for 2 to 3 years compared with 10 years in the social housing market. And that is, as Sinn Féin McMahon said, has a big impact on children. You know, we're 1 in 4 of these households have children. It puts people in vulnerable situations because they can be put in a situation where a landlord ends a tenancy at short notice. And as Ken McIntosh noted in his contribution, the people can struggle to find alternative accommodation. They also can be put in a position where rent rises are put up at short notice, but they don't have any alternatives. And what it really comes down to is a position of power. The power in this situation is with the landlords and the letting agents, and I think more of it needs to be shifted onto giving rights to individual tenants. And that is why Labour in the Housing Bill brought forward practical amendments to look to address the issue of rising rent levels and also of security of tenure. And we've heard SNP backbencher after backbencher talk about the importance of the private rented sector and addressing the issues in that sector. But every one of you, when given the opportunity, voted down the Labour proposals. You voted down the opportunity to help your constituents. In terms of, you know, I think everybody can quote statistics back and forward, but I think if you look at the contribution that Siobhan McMahon made in terms of her constituent, well, the constituent, because of the rent levels that he's paying, couldn't afford to feed himself, you know, and had to go to his parents' house in order to get meals. That shows you the reality of what's happening on the ground. And in terms of the Conservative and government amendments, I think they need to open their eyes to these issues. I think just on the amendments, also I think it's unfortunate that the Green Amendment wasn't selected, because that would have given the opportunity you know, to focus on some of the issues that students face in terms of rent levels, because there's no doubt that these issues in terms of security of tenure and rent levels, they hit students very hard indeed. I think the Tory motion and the Tory Alec Johnson's contributions during the debate, to me, they laud, you know, the growth of the private rented sector and the benefit that that is to the economy, but they don't acknowledge issues like the rising rent levels that people are going to have to contribute, and also the rising levels of people in the private rented sector in poverty. You know, it's one thing to laud the growth in that sector, but if those poverty levels continue to grow, then that is a real problem in communities throughout Scotland. I think in terms of the SNP amendment, it's one that, you know, is really staggering in terms of its complacency. The government in its amendment, and the various speakers have told us this, how they published a strategy in 2013, and the amendment tells us how they've made great progress with the strategy, because we're now having a consultation. So having a strategy published 18 months ago, we're now having a consultation to talk about the issues. I'll take the Minister.
The strategy covered a number of other areas in terms of repair, in terms of tenancy deposits, in terms of the, and now we've got the regulation of letting agents. We've done a number of things in terms of the private sector, and we're now consulting on the tenancy regime and rents.
So Kelly, your
Minister,
final
you acknowledged in your opening contribution that in 2010 you recognised there were issues with the private rented sector. This government has had 2 bills, a strategy and a consultation, and nothing in last week's legislative programme to address the issues of rent increases or security of tenure. This government is on go slow in terms of housing. It's time that we saw some action. Because if you look at what's happening to people on the ground, they're asking the question, the SNP government are in power, what are you going to do with that power? If you're in a situation where you can't pay your bills, you can't pay your energy bills, or you can't pay for your food, or your landlord turns up at short notice and introduces an excessive rent rise, then you look at the response of this SNP government and we want to have a strategy, we want to have a consultation. It's not enough to chat about it. Not enough to chat about it. It's time that we had some action. It's time that you stood up on behalf of tenants instead of backing the Tories and the rogue letting agents and landlords. We want action now.
Thanks very much. And that concludes the debate on private sector rent reform. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 11766 in the name of Neil Findlay on the state of the NHS. I'd invite members who wish to speak in their debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And Mr Findlay, when you are ready, I'd invite you to move the motion in your name, at which point you will have 10 minutes. Microphone for Mr Findlay, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The NHS is without doubt the greatest social policy of any government. The collective pooling of our taxes to provide healthcare for all free at the point of need was a revolution in healthcare, resulting in a system where we contribute according to the ability to pay and where each citizen of this country can use the system according to need. That is something we should never take for granted and all of us should work to protect. But our NHS is under pressure like never before, from the front door of the GP surgery through the social care sector. The pressures across the system are immense. In primary care in my region alone, 27 GP surgeries have full or restricted waiting lists. Workforce pressures are piling up, and when a GP is off sick or retires, finding a replacement or a locum is almost impossible. I recently met with managers at two practices, both of whom told me there were no applicants for their particular vacancy. Yet rather than address these pressures, the Scottish Government has been cutting GP funding. The budget for general practice has been declining steadily, and next year there is a real terms further cut of 2.2%. The Royal College has raised concerns about the dangerous consequences for patients in light of continued underfunding. Waiting times for appointment are up, consultations are...
I just wonder if Neil Findlay would recognise the £40 million that was announced by Alec Neil to invest in GP surgeries, particularly in more deprived communities and rural areas. Surely that's something he would welcome.
Of course, always welcome more money, but this is about across the board, and this is about across a long period of time where the budget has been declining. We see waiting times for appointments up, consultations getting shorter, weakening the relationship between the doctor and their patient, and all contributing to, in the words of the Royal College, a crisis in general practice. This situation is evidence of a government failing to face up to the pressures of our local doctors and the wider NHS itself. No thanks. And let's have a look at what Audit Scotland say about the NHS. Their report should have been a wake-up call to the government. They say the current level of focus on meeting waiting times targets may not be sustainable when combined with additional pressures of increasing demand and tightening budgets. But, Presiding Officer, whatever anyone thinks of targets, they are there in order to monitor and drive performance. The role of government is to ensure that the NHS is given the right level of resources to successfully meet those targets. No, thank you. But, of course, they are failing to meet them, not just their own initial targets, but the lower targets that this government themselves set. Audit Scotland also said there are signs that NHS boards are facing increasing difficulty meeting their financial targets, and some are doing this in unsustainable ways. Four boards require additional funding from the Scottish Government to break even, and five continue to rely on high levels of non-recurring savings. These financial constraints are undoubtedly related to the reduction in real terms to the funds allocated to the Scottish NHS. As recently reported by the Institute for Fiscal Studies, the Scottish Government budget has fallen by more than the NHS in England. So much for the progressive credentials of this SNP government and its promise to protect the NHS.
Secretary.
We have said very clearly that we are committed to a real terms increase, not just in this Parliament, but next. On the Hustings debate for the leadership elections, Neil Findlay refused to give that commitment. Will he give that commitment now?
Findlay?
I'll deal with the leadership election out with this chamber. That's a different matter. Let's deal with what we're dealing with in here. Let's deal with what you're dealing with in here. Presiding officer, the consequences are being felt everywhere. Accident and emergency departments are full, unable to cope with increased demand and expectations. Staff tell me that they are frazzled. There is a recruitment crisis and junior doctors under huge pressure, looking after up to 100 beds while still working far too long hours. I know through my own family and friends how skilled our NHS workforce is. I also recognise that when people are admitted to hospital, the vast majority of the time they receive first-class treatment, but the number of complaints is on the rise, up 23%, as are staff complaints about bullying and intimidation, whilst whistleblowing procedures remain wholly inadequate. Presiding officer, if it wasn't for the dedication and commitment of NHS staff, then the system would, I fear, be on its knees. And of course, one of the biggest issues faced in the health and social care system is delayed discharges. In 2011, the then Cabinet Secretary took action to reduce delayed discharges when the figure reached 200,000 bed days lost, and said it would be resolved. Now what do we see? 421,000 bed days lost a year. Patients stuck in hospital when they could have been at home, all at a cost of £78 million. This represents an abject failure of this government's stated policy of shifting the balance of care. Teresa Fife of the RCN said last week, the figures published today on delayed discharges are further evidence that our NHS is under pressure. One of the worrying aspects of the figures published today is that we've not hit the winter months yet. If this is no, thank you. If this is happening over the summer months, what's it going to be like between December and February, when many more patients, particularly our most elderly and vulnerable, are admitted to hospital? And of course, directly linked to this is social care, where we have one of the greatest scandals of our time. Our elderly and vulnerable friends and relatives being cared for by staff, desperate to care but unable to do so. Council budgets cut by 11%, with authorities shackled, unable to raise money. 15-minute care visits the norm, a minimum wage sector, with carers only staying in the job long enough until they can find a job elsewhere. I met a young girl recently who got a job in social care. She received 4 days training in an office, 1.5 days shadowing another carer, and was then sent out on her own. On her first day, she had 30 clients to visit. The first man had a catheter in. She didn't know what it was, never mind how to deal with it. The next person she went to had a personality disorder and was abusive to her. She didn't know what to do. And her day went on like that. She was paid until 5 p.m, but only finished her day's work at 10 at night. And for her rewards, she was given £5.13 an hour. This is what we are doing to our elderly loved ones and to the young carers of the future. And what is the government's response? Well, the First Minister last week announced an extra £5 million would be put in place to deal with delayed discharges, but that councils would have to match fund the government's contribution. Presiding officer, what planet is the First Minister living on? Council budgets are being hammered by this government. Services are closing, jobs being lost, assets being sold. So can the Cabinet Secretary give me and our council some idea of where this money is going to come from? I'll give way if she wants to tell us where the money is coming from.
Okay. I'll give way. local government have been very constructive, unlike the member, in responding to these challenges. And if you remember, it's actually a tripartite funding agreement between local government, the health service and the Scottish Government. That's what constructive proposals are. Maybe the member could give us a constructive proposal in the remainder of his speech.
We don't know where the money is coming from, but local governments defined it. That's the way in which this government treats local government. And we have similar problems in the care home sector. Staff shortages, low pay, training budgets cut, falling standards, and every week stories in the press about neglect and the poor care of residents. Across Scotland, care home places are vacant because councils will not allocate to them because of concern over the quality of care. And yet neither the government nor the care inspectorate know the extent of the problem, as they don't collate the information. This cannot go on. We have to make social care a fairly paid, rewarding career, raising standards to ensure we do genuinely shift the balance of care. And that will never, ever happen with a system based on a race to the bottom like we have at the moment.
Final minute.
Presiding officer, two previous cabinet secretaries for health operated a denial strategy, pretending that everything was okay when reality was staring them in the face. So we now have staffing shortages across many disciplines: GPs, midwives, specialist nurses, paediatricians, psychiatrists, emergency medicine, anaesthetists. The list goes on. Vacancies for consultant posts have doubled. Spending on locums up by 60%. Spending on agency staff up by 106% over the last 2 years, and money continuing to leak out of the system into the private sector. In the last few days, we have had the report into the Vale of Leven, the Royal Infirmary in Aberdeen and NHS Grampian, and there are serious issues in Fife, Lanarkshire, the Lothians and across Scotland. If there ever was a time to accept our argument for a whole-scale review of our NHS and the establishment of a truly independent health regulator, then that time is now. I hope the new Cabinet Secretary will reject the arrogant approach of her predecessors and do exactly that.
Many thanks. I now call on Shona Robertson to speak to and move Amendment 11766.3. Maximum 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The NHS is a fantastic institution, and as the new Cabinet Secretary for Health, I'm grateful for this opportunity to put on record my appreciation for the effort and dedication of those NHS staff who work tirelessly day in and day out to deliver a high-quality service. It's also my first opportunity to see what a privilege it is to have responsibility for the NHS within the Scottish Government. The NHS must always strive to seek further improvements in the delivery of care, but we shouldn't lose sight of where we have come from and the progress that has been made. We have a clear vision and direction for our health service as part of the 2020 Vision for Health and Social Care, which has secured and will secure huge benefits as we move forward with integration over the next few years. The NHS is absolutely our top priority, and we're making significant financial investment in our health service. NHS frontline resource budget will be protected and receive an above inflation increase in 2015-16. Indeed, the total health budget will receive a real terms increase in 2015-16, taking it over to £12 billion for the first time. And I actually think that the debate has to shift now about how we better use that resource. It is a significant resource. My job is to make sure that that resource begins to achieve the things that absolutely we need to achieve. Yes.
Neil Findlay.
I wonder if she could reflect on the social care resource that's available.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, that's why we have moved to the integration of health and social care. But within Neil Findlay's opening statement, he called for more money for health, he called for more money for social care. What we need to do is to make sure the money that is within the system, the £12 billion within health, the huge resources that are within social care, are actually delivering the improvements that need to be made. And, of course, that is what I will be focusing on doing. And of course, as I said earlier on, we have committed to ensuring real terms rises for the health resource budget for each and every year of the next Parliament. And I note that Neil Findlay didn't take the opportunity to make that commitment himself. So I do think that pulls the rug somewhat from under his argument about resources. Under this government, we have increased the number of NHS staff to record levels. Yesterday, you saw the workforce statistics showing that there are 7.6% more staff working in the NHS, which translates into more than 9,600 staff, more doctors, dentists, AHPs, nurses and support staff. We're also, of course, aware that the NHS is treating more people than ever before, whilst at the same time reducing how long people have to wait for treatment. The number of inpatient cases has increased by over 162,000 under this government, with day cases up by over 45,500. The latest statistics show 97% of new inpatient day cases seen within 12 weeks. So yes, there is more resource, but more people being treated. Yes.
John Pentland.
Convention. If you believe that we have progressed, do you then share my concern about the current plans to close any departments in Lanarkshire and agree that we need both urgent action to address staff shortages and a full independent review of future plans to address the many issues affecting health provision in Lanarkshire?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member could do with a bit of a dose of self-awareness, given where we've been with A&E departments in Lanarkshire. It was this government that saved the A&E department at Monklands. A recent report by the Nuffield Trust into elective waiting times across the four UK countries found that Scotland had the shortest waits for 9 out of the 11 common procedures, including hip replacements and cataract removal. On unscheduled care, it is clear that challenges remain. It should be noted that performance in Scotland's core accident and emergency departments remains the highest of all the UK countries and significantly above the level that we inherited. And we couldn't deliver this without the dedicated, highly motivated and hard-working staff in the NHS. We have a clear vision for our workforce and, of course, we have committed to ensuring that NHS Scotland staff are rewarded fairly for the work that they do, which is why, unlike England and Wales, we have accepted the recommendations of the independent pay review bodies on pay for 2014-15 and why we have a no compulsory redundancy policy in place. We are ensuring that all NHS staff are paid at least the living wage and that there are and that we will make sure that we ensure that our staff are well motivated and well rewarded for the job that they do. However, I am absolutely not complacent. I spoke in this Parliament earlier today about the challenges identified in NHS Grampian and last week about the Vale of Leven report. This government will absolutely not shy away, and neither will I, from acknowledging and addressing the challenges facing the NHS. We know that the service will face pressures this winter. Winter planning is a key part of our unscheduled care programme. We've developed winter plans with the boards and their partners to prepare for the disruptions that winter can bring. NHS boards are also testing and communicating their business continuity plans to ensure that critical services are maintained. To deal with these challenges, I am clear that my focus has to be on the next few months in driving forward the shift in the balance of care, to drive forward health and social care integration, to deal with delayed discharge. In presenting the government's programme for the year ahead, the First Minister made it clear that addressing delayed discharge is one of our key priorities and one in which I give my own personal commitment. Very briefly.
Thank you for giving way, Cabinet Secretary. It was yourself in 2008 that said we've reached Labour's target of zero for delayed discharges. In 24 of the last quarters since then, delayed discharges over 6 weeks have not been met, and you now have a 4-week target with a 2-week one coming in April. Let's have a little bit of realism.
Cabinet Secretary, you're in your last minute.
I think by saying that delayed discharge is my top priority gives you a sense of realism. But of course, when I dealt with delayed discharge, it was an inherited delayed discharge problem that your previous administration left us. And we did deal with it. And
order, please.
Deal with it.
Order, please. The Minister's Cabinet Secretary is concluding.
And I don't want to leave you under any illusion. But, you know, just to finish on this, Presiding Officer, Labour, in the absence of any other policies, continue to call for a review, a Beveridge-style review. That review, that Beveridge-style review, took 4 years. I don't want to put the NHS on pause for 4 years. I want to get on and solve the problems. We know what the problems are in the NHS. We don't need a review to tell us that. What we need is the action to deal with the problems, to make sure that the NHS continually delivers
Cabinet
the high-level service
must conclude,
that we
please.
Expect. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. I now call on Annette Millen to speak to and move amendment 11766.2, maximum 5 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin in the short time allotted to me by endorsing the opening statement of Labour's motion and paying tribute to the staff of NHS Scotland. The vast majority of these people work in the NHS because they want to help patients, and they work tirelessly to this end. And that applies right across the board, within the community and in our hospitals, from the most senior consultants to the most junior medical staff, from nurses and AHPs to the cooks, cleaners, porters and secretaries, who all play their part in running the vast organisation that is NHS Scotland in the 21st century. Compared to many in the private sector, they are not well paid, but by and large they derive immense satisfaction from the work that they do, and they do deserve our gratitude and our support. When I think back over the near half century since I qualified in medicine, the achievements of the present-day NHS are incredible and growing due to the many advances in technology and medical research and the development of more and more sophisticated medicines and procedures. In 1965, hip replacements were a dream, transplants unheard of, and cancer unmentionable and virtually incurable. The flip side of this is that more and more people are living much longer and with complex medical conditions. And of course the NHS is under pressure to provide the expected and sadly often taken for granted services. So there has to be new thinking about how demand is to be met, and the silo mentality and professional empires that I grew up with are having to change. And that's not easy when none of us really like to change our habits and get out of our comfort zones. The pressures are evident in the difficulty in meeting waiting times targets, in increasing attendances at A&E departments, in delayed discharges from hospitals, in maintaining the NHS estate and infrastructure and developing it for future needs, and in attracting sufficient members of staff at all levels to deal with patient demand. These pressures, of course, aren't just within the NHS in Scotland, but they are present across all modern systems of healthcare, and we have to learn how to cope with them. I think the pinch points are well known, and I think we all have to work together to address them. That's why I don't particularly like the inflammatory language in Labour's motion about a race to the bottom, because the aim of people associated with the NHS is to maintain and improve quality, and to do that, it is imperative that patient well-being is our focus, and that we move forward with this in mind, using the increasing, though finite, resources at our disposal to try and achieve the laudable 2020 vision that is the Scottish Government's target. We are fortunate that the NHS budget has been protected in recent years, not least due to the Barnett consequentials from the UK government's health policy, which has given Scotland an extra £3 billion since 2010, and with more to come every year following today's autumn statement. But there will always be a demand for more money, and how it's spent is clearly a matter of political choice. For example, Scottish Conservatives would pledge an extra 1,000 nurses and midwives paid for by restoring the prescription charge, except for the young, the pensioner, the pregnant, and those on low incomes who would remain exempt, as they always have been. So, Presiding Officer, rather than spend valuable time and money on a wholesale review of the NHS, I believe new ways need to be found to make the best use of resource moving forward. To do this, our total focus must be on the best outcomes for patients, who, where possible, want to live at home or in homely community settings. And to this end, we must involve people early in their lives and instill in them the importance of taking responsibility for their own health by making appropriate lifestyle choices to help them to keep well and active for as long as possible, thereby reducing their demands on the NHS. It is also vital that the integration of health and social care moves forward apace, which will mean more emphasis on primary care, not just doctors.
Indeed. Cabinet Secretary.
On the integration of health and social care, I'm certainly very willing to offer opposition members a briefing on the plans and the progress that is being made, as well as winter pressures, delayed discharge, if that would be something you'd find helpful.
Nanette Milne, you're in your last minute.
Cabinet Secretary has almost stolen the bit of my speech. It is advisable that it moves forward, not just doctors, but HPs and nurses of all grades, local authorities and third sector organisations which provide much of the care within communities so that patients can experience a relatively seamless transition between levels of care as they progress through life. To make this a reality, all interested parties will have to come together, forget their professional and cultural differences and work towards achieving a long-term effective plan to secure the future of Scotland's NHS. The previous Health Secretary was very keen to progress in this way, particularly to involve politicians from all sides in moving forward, as evidenced, for example, by the Scottish Government's welcome investment in the 500 extra health visitors, a group of health professionals which my party greatly values and seeks even more. I'm pleased that the Cabinet Secretary has indicated that she will perhaps follow in his footsteps in this regard, and if so, she can be assured of our support and our involvement in pursuit of a sustainable and high-quality NHS for Scotland.
Thank you very much. I now turn to the open debate. We are very short of time. Speeches of 4 minutes at the moment, but I'm afraid our last two speakers may not get 4 minutes. Bob Dorris to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Presiding Officer, the Labour motion before us today identifies a number of pressures in Scotland's NHS. However, the motion is also one-sided, it's partial
and it gives an incomplete picture and impression of our National Health Service. I do appreciate that it's an opposition's job to oppose, but on Scotland's NHS, even despite this motion, I would hope we could still garner a good degree of consensus across political parties. That remains my hope. For every statistic which signals pressures on our NHS, and there certainly are pressures, there's always another one pointing to progress and improvement in patient care, whether it's on waiting times, where by June 2014, 97.2% of people were treated within a 12-week waiting guarantee. I'm minded that in March 2007, that number was only 85%, and that was an 18-week wait. That's progress. On whether it's patient safety, 14.2% increase improvement in the mortality rate. Surely that's progress. On hygiene, for our elderly patients, C. diff has fallen by nearly 82%. Surely that's progress. On staffing, record number of consultants compared to 2007, a 36% increase. Surely that's progress. An increase in trained nurses and midwives. Surely that's progress. By admitting that progress exists doesn't mean we deny that pressures remain. And I think that's a key aspect of the tone for this debate. You can admit there's pressures without denying there's been progress, and Labour singularly fail to do that within their motion. So let's look what a root and branch or a full-scale review could mean. Perhaps it could mean tackling unscheduled care, people turning up at accident and emergency units. Yes, let's do that. Let's look at preventative action, and let's look at patient flow through hospitals. Let's call it an unscheduled care action plan, and let's put £50 million towards it. Hang on, presiding officer, we are already doing it. Perhaps we should look at delayed discharge. Perhaps the government should put in an additional £10 million. Perhaps we should work with our partners in the NHS and in local authorities to have a £20 million pot, and we should have a delayed discharge action plan. Hang on, presiding officer, we're actually already doing it. Perhaps we have to make sure health and social care integration works better. Indeed, perhaps we have to legislate to make sure it happens, because some local authorities weren't doing it. Once again, presiding officer, hang on, that's precisely what we've done. The point I'm trying to make, presiding officer, is the NHS is an institution under constant review. I know that very well as deputy convener of the Health and Sport Committee, where actually I work in partnership across parties to improve the NHS. Whether that's the £40 million New Medicines Fund, where we had a root and branch review of access to medicines in Scotland, we did it by keeping the NHS under constant review. Whether it's tackling the regulation and the care inspection of older people's homes across Scotland to make it that more robust, we already did it as the Health and Sport Committee in partnership with the government. Perhaps it's looking at targets and working out whether the targets we collect in the NHS are the appropriate ones in the appropriate place at the important time. Anyone following budget scrutiny at the Health and Sport Committee just now will see we've already taken evidence on that. So, presiding officer, undoubtedly there's pressures in the NHS. I'm delighted the Scottish Government has a real terms increase. I notice Neil Findlay won't guarantee that, but it's under constant review, and more important, it's under constant persistent progress and advancement.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Mark MacDonald.
Thank you, presiding officer. I want to welcome the Cabinet Secretary to her post and indeed her first health debate today. But it's surely telling that she's already made two statements to this chamber in her 2 short weeks in her post, all dealing with the crisis in the NHS. The Labour motion today talks about the sad state of the NHS in Scotland, and this deterioration has not happened overnight. It's been presided over for a number of years by this Scottish Government, and I really wonder how bad things will get before they take our advice and carry out a root and branch review of the NHS in Scotland. Is there reluctance due to their own mismanagement and the fear that the review will highlight that incompetence? In response to questions on the statement today earlier, the Cabinet Secretary said she wants to know, warts and all, where the problems within our NHS service are, because the only way of knowing it is only by knowing that we can actually take steps to address it. Perhaps she wants to.
Cabinet Secretary.
That's
why we have the independent inspectorate that we set up to do that. But I wonder if the member can tell us how long this review would take. Would all the things that we're doing around health and social care integration be put on pause while this review happens? So what's its purpose if it's actually not to stop doing the actual changes in the NHS that we're doing? What is its purpose and what will be its outcome?
Rhoda Grant.
The review would take as long as it needed to take to ensure we had an NHS fit for the 21st century. Alongside that review, you would need and would have to tackle with the problems that are occurring on a weekly basis here and now that you're standing up in the chamber talking about. We need to address not only those problems, but we have to look at the NHS to make sure it is fit for the 21st century. And the only way of doing that is having a review to identify the pressures and indeed plot the way forward. Otherwise, we fail the patients using the NHS and indeed the NHS and the staff working within it. It is not good enough to depend on the goodwill of staff to keep it from crumbling altogether. Presiding officer, in the short time available to me, I want to touch on one of the issues impacting on the NHS, and that is the inadequacy of health and care in the community. The Scottish Government's cuts to council budgets have led to choices being made between feeding old people or indeed educating young people. That is the choices councils are facing today. They promised to fund the council tax freeze, but they didn't, leaving the most vulnerable in our society paying the care tax, leaving them with little or nothing to live on. This is a scandalous care tax and needs to end now. Very briefly.
William Watt.
Would the member like to tell us which budgets all this money should come from?
Rhoda Grant.
Well, it is very interesting that the Scottish Government is looking forward to receiving consequentials from the UK Government. Surely that could go towards ending the care tax and allowing people to live with dignity.
Final minute.
I'm hearing sedentary comments about the NHS. Surely the NHS happens in our communities as well as in hospitals. And that is the nub of the issue. This government believes the NHS only happens in hospitals. So we need to treat people in the community, because if we don't, what has happened is people are now going into hospitals. Their policy is taking people in due to unscheduled care because of the inadequate health care in the community, and leads to bed blocking as well. Because if people can't get out into the community without adequate health care and indeed community care, they remain in hospital. And hospital is a dangerous place for older people. They get stuck, becoming frailer, losing their strength, their ability to look after themselves, and that is all due to inadequate care in the community.
You must come to a close, please.
Presiding officer, I want to be clear that we need to change the NHS, and this government must take responsibility for that change. We need a Beveridge-style review. Sooner or later, the government will be forced to do it. I just hope that we don't go further back before they do.
I'm afraid I don't have any time for interventions. Members must take in their own time. Mark MacDonald to be followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Very interesting to hear Rhoda Grant calling for consequentials to go to local government when this government has said that they will put them to health, especially when some of her own backbenchers are in the Press and Journal calling for consequentials to go directly to NHS Grampian. Labour seem to have a very flexible attitude to how many times you can spend the same pot of money. It's little wonder they find themselves in opposition in this chamber. It's also very interesting, Presiding Officer, to listen to the Labour Party when questioned about this review that they want to set up. It appears to have no terms of reference, no defined timescale, and nobody who they've identified who would lead said review. They just want somebody else to do their own work for them, because there's an utter policy vacuum in the health brief in the Labour Party. They've not come up with one single proactive or constructive policy initiative since Mr Findlay took on the health brief. If that's the approach that we have to look forward to from Neil Findlay leadership in the Labour Party, he has my full backing in the leadership contest, and I look forward to him leading. After all, the deputy leader candidate who is aligned to Neil Findlay has said today that any other outcome would lead to certain defeat for the Labour Party in 2016. I'm sure he would be endorsing Katie Clark's view that Kezia Dugdale represents certain defeat for the Labour Party in 2016, given he's aligned with her in this campaign. But there is undoubtedly, well, Mr Findlay calls again from a sedentary position. I know he's an adherent of Marxist principles. I think today he's a bit more Groucho than Carl. Most of us yearn... Most of, Most of us yearn for the day when he's a bit more like Harpo, to be honest with you, presiding officer. Can I say there has undoubtedly been progress in terms of the National Health Service in Scotland. For example, if I can quote, we have come a long way. A decade ago, many of us who are sitting around the table were inundated with cases involving people who could not get an operation. They have disappeared in my caseload, so there have been tremendous gains, which you may laugh, but that's Duncan McNeill, the convener of the Health and Sport Committee and a Labour MSP saying that. So you can laugh at Duncan McNeill's quote, but he clearly recognises there has been progress with the National Health Service. But there are pressures, presiding officer. Undoubtedly, there are pressures. There have always been pressures since the inception of the National Health Service. And Nanette Mullen, I thought, summed that up very well by talking about the medical advancements that have been made over time, which undoubtedly, while benefiting the population, do increase pressures on the National Health Service. And those also lead on to the demographic trends that we are now seeing. First of all, the one thing we need to get beyond, I think, is talking about demographic trends as if they are a problem. They're not a problem. People living longer is a good thing. What we have to ensure is that people are living not just longer lives, but healthier lives. And that involves some of the early intervention work that this government is focused on. And I think the work around health and social care integration will assist greatly in that, because for too many people, there is a gap between those two particular silos into which people all too often fall. And delayed discharge is a key issue on this. When I was on Aberdeen City Council, we had delayed discharge down to zero. There has been a real difficulty at present in the city in terms of getting appropriate care packages in place for individuals. And a large part of that problem is because the City of Aberdeen Council, Labour-led by the way, have decided to hive off social care to an arm's-length company, Bonacord Care, which has zero democratic oversight from local councillors. And I'm in my last 40 seconds. Zero democratic oversight from local councillors, zero democratic accountability, and that is leading to a real difficulty for my constituents in the City of Aberdeen, many of whom are stuck waiting for appropriate care packages so they can go home. Finally, very briefly, on GP surgeries, I accept there's been a long-term issue there. If you take Inverurie, the place where I was born, the GP surgery has never been expanded despite the exponential growth in population since the time I was born. Presiding officer, there are too many practices which have failed to benefit as a result of planning gain. That's been a failure by both health boards and local authorities in the past. I've had conversations with the previous Cabinet Secretary about it. I'd be delighted to have further conversations with the new Cabinet Secretary about how perhaps we could look at using the planning gain system to help alleviate some of the pressures on GP premises, many of which are indeed approaching or at capacity.
I'm afraid you must close. Thank you. Lewis MacDonald to be followed by Richard Lyle.
A health service under pressure, struggling to recruit staff and to meet targets, relying on the dedication of hard-working frontline staff to compensate for its lack of clinical assurance systems and to maintain the quality and safety of patient care. That is the picture of NHS Grampian portrayed in report after report published this week. A service underfunded against the government's own formula to the tune of £158 million over 5 years, cutting 400 nursing posts over 4 years in an effort to balance the books, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Could the member tell us what the funding formula led to for NHS Grampian under the previous Labour administration?
Lewis MacDonald.
Certainly. The previous administration put in place the National Resource Allocation Committee, which commissioned a review of funding. The incoming SNP government accepted the recommendations of that commission. The gap between what they provided and what the National Resource Allocation Committee said they should provide was £26.6 million in 2010. It's £29.7 million this year.
Exactly.
It is little wonder that Ellen Hudson of the Royal College of Nursing said yesterday that the Scottish Government should have recognised the problems in NHS Grampian earlier and taken action to address them. But that is not all. In addition to the challenges facing other health boards across Scotland, NHS Grampian has also had to deal with a small group of senior staff who have claimed to be whistleblowers while actively undermining the first principles of public service. Yesterday's reports revealed that a small number of consultants had exhibited, and I quote, unprofessional, offensive and unacceptable behaviour, that they had contributed to an environment where 40% of hospital consultants have not agreed a job plan in spite of a contractual obligation to do so, and where many staff believe that in Grampian there are, I quote, no consequences for consultants who behave in inappropriate ways. Neil Dixon, the Chief Executive of the General Medical Council, said yesterday that they were extremely concerned that large numbers of consultants had no job plans and there was minimal evidence that clinical governance structures were working effectively. This is not just about the failure of NHS Grampian to get to grips with unacceptable behaviour by a handful of senior staff. The Scottish Government also has questions to answer about its role in permitting this situation to develop. Healthcare Improvement Scotland reports that the minutes of the Medical Staff Committee suggest that this group sees itself as an alternative management structure rather than as an advisory body. Managers told HIS that clinicians would tell managers what to do and threaten escalation to Scottish Government. And incredibly, the reviewers from HIS reported that, I quote, "we heard remarks by some consultants that confirmed this." The arrogance of repeating such boasts in front of external reviewers answerable to ministers says it all. Certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
Would the member not accept that the fact that we have had HIS in doing the investigation, that all of this has been exposed into the light of day and action has been taken, actually shows that as soon as we became aware of those issues, we did take action?
Lewis MacDonald, last minute.
I absolutely welcome that, and I welcomed it earlier this afternoon. But we need to know why those consultants formed the view that they were untouchable and that they could go direct to government if they didn't get their own way. We need to know how often government ministers entertained escalation out with the proper channels. And we need to know which ministers were involved. But above all, we need to know what ministers will now do to support NHS Grampian in addressing the issues raised by these reports, given the potential for patients' care and safety to be further compromised, which they show. The recommendations have been accepted. They now need to be implemented. The recommendations by the Royal College of Surgeons have been published. The conclusions have not, and they should be published as soon as possible. The interim chief executive of NHS Grampian deserves all our full support. But that must include urgent additional resources to address the pressing problems of inadequate nurse staffing levels and recruitment across the board. Urgency, openness, resources and local confidence are all required to allow NHS Grampian to move forward. And that is the challenge for the Scottish Government.
Many thanks. Richard Lyle to be followed by Jim Hume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin my remarks this afternoon by reflecting on the work that the NHS does? Scotland's National Health Service is a world leader in health care, public service that is absolutely essential to the lives of everyone who lives in our country. No matter young, old, at some point our lives will be called. We will call on the services of our NHS. Now, with specific reference to Mr Finlay's motion, I note with interest that he calls for a full-scale review of the NHS to address the broad range of pressures being identified in all areas of the NHS. It may interest members to know that the document entitled NHS Board Projected Staff and Post Changes for 2014-15, produced by the Scottish Government, the document makes clear, and I quote, that the NHS boards across the country have been asked to develop local delivery plans, workforce plans, as well as using workforce workload tools in order to assess if service redesign or changes in skill mix are required to best meet the needs of their population. Presiding Officer, the people who know best are those who are at the heart of the issue, those who are involved in the delivery of our NHS at a local level. I believe that the rollout of these local delivery plans and workforce plans are the essential instrument to identify the areas that need improved within a particular local service, and those areas are performing well. The motion by Mr Finlay also asks that the Government address the broad range of pressures being identified in all areas by the NHS, in the NHS by staff and patients. Presiding Officer, I also read with interest the latest NHS Scotland Chief Executive report. I noted that the report that the NHS Scotland, as a component of their 2020 vision route map, have developed their 2020 workforce vision, a vision which concerns all NHS Scotland staff and has implications for staff across health and social care together. The document goes on to say that the vision was informed by 10,000 voices, and one of the largest qualitative exercises undertaken in NHS in Scotland, listen to views of the staff and those working in healthcare. Therefore, I must say to the Labour Party, this Government has always had a commitment to engage, discuss, listen to staff, patients and those in healthcare, involved in healthcare. I would like to look at those pressures that are raised in the motion. There can be no doubt there are significant financial pressures facing our National Health Service. However, I am proud that this Government's record of standing up and protecting our NHS. Our attitude towards the NHS is a stark contrast to that of those in the Government south of the border. To coin a phrase, a race to the bottom is taking place to privatise the NHS in Scotland, in England, but here in Scotland, our Government's commitment to protect the NHS is clear. The draft budget 2015-2016, the Government made clear that despite the UK Government having cut the Scottish Government's resource budget in real terms, we have maintained our commitment that the NHS frontline resource budget will be protected and will increase at least in line with inflation.
Members, in his final minute.
To conclude, Presiding Officer, our Government has a track record of protecting the NHS despite cuts enforced by Westminster. The Labour Party would do well to remember that. Our Government is committed to engaging and listening to all involved in healthcare in Scotland. Our Government will always seek to improve where possible. In particular, in NHS Lanarkshire, this has improved cancer rates to 95.7% for cancer patients starting treatment within 62 days of urgently offered situation. This compares with 70.3% in the first quarter of 2007. A massive improvement. I thank all involved in our National Health Service for the outstanding work they do and continue to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Jim Hume to be followed by Christian Allard. I'm afraid I can only give you just over 3 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that Labour have used their time to discuss our NHS. Let me at the outset do as others have done and say that the people who make our NHS do extraordinary work. They save lives, but they also improve lives. I have a veteran friend, Chris McDivitt, who just in 14 hours will go under the NHS, and I'm sure they'll do their utmost to get him mobile again. So our thanks go out to the NHS. We know that the quality of patient care is directly related to having the right people with the right skills in the right place at the right time. Worryingly, then, the 2013 NHS Scotland staff survey showed that only 45% of staff agreed that care of patients was the top priority of their health board. That's down 54% from 2010. Only 32% felt that they could meet all the conflicting demands on their time at work, and under a quarter thought there were enough staff to do the job properly. In the RCN members' survey of 2013, 64% of those working in NHS hospitals said that they were too busy to provide the level of care that they would like, and 81% recorded an increase in their workload in the last year. The Government's vision, 2020 vision, simply will not be achieved unless we do have meaningful change. As I've said before to the previous Health Secretary, the Government rattling off a list of where they've made investment misses the point. That it isn't just about one-off injections of cash, it's about ensuring the skill mixes are right. I've only 3 minutes, I'm sorry, Minister. The Minister, of course, must recognise the system is at breaking point. Yesterday, figures showed that more NHS posts are lying vacant and for longer than was previously the case. Last week, figures revealed an alarming rise in the number of delayed discharges, that fewer patients are being treated within the targeted 18 weeks between referral to first treatment, that 56,252 patients in NHS Scotland were waiting for one of the 8 key diagnostic tests, a 19% increase on the 2013 figure, and they were waiting longer for them, and that A&E four-hour performances had worsened, with 242 patients spending more than 12 hours in A&E. I don't think that a full-scale review is the best course of action at this moment. We know what the problems are, and we have a good sense of the pressures. What we need is solutions, so with that in mind, perhaps the Labour Party could come up with some suggestions, perhaps 3 solid policy ideas which would go some way to alleviate the pressures on our NHS and transform it to the service we all want. A review will in itself not achieve this change. It will put all on hold and will slow down actions that desperately need addressed now.
Thank you very much. And finally, I call Christian Allard before we turn to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary could not be clear earlier this afternoon in a statement on NHS Grampian. The work done by Healthcare Improvement Scotland did not identify constituent and widespread concern about patient safety. Aberdeen Royal Infirmary is not significantly different from the Scottish average. In June 2014, NHS Grampian's performance against the 4-hour accident and emergency target was 96.1%. Across Scotland, it's 93.5%. This is to compare with the 91.3% in April 2006. Or we could compare with the Labour administration in Wales, where it is at 86.3%. If Neil Findlay is concerned about recent statistics at accident and emergency, he will have to agree that Labour is not the answer to his concerns. Where I agree with Mr Finlay is that NHS staff in Scotland are working tirelessly under pressure to deliver high-quality care to patients. This is what the report found out in Grampian. We all know where the pressure comes from, funding from Westminster, an ageing population and the increasing challenge of recruiting. I do welcome that the NHS budget is protected in Scotland under this government and that the health workforce is rising to a record high. Presiding officer, NHS consultant numbers are at a record level under this government. And I agree with Bob Doris about the tone of the Labour motion. As for example, patients' confidence in NHS Scotland, let me paint another picture of our public health service in my contribution today. There's an independent site online about patients' experiences of the health service. This site allows patients, carers, family and friends of patients to tell their own stories. The site is called Patient Opinion. Every voice matters. I receive regular emails, and maybe some of the members receive the same emails, and I receive emails regarding what's happening in the health services across the North East. One of them is from an Aberdeen patient. I was in a lot of pain, she said, and went to the Aberdeen Health Village, where a lovely woman treated me. She broke the news about my condition very considerately and was a huge support, offering me lots of different treatments and advice. I was scared and upset, but she made me feel so much better about the whole situation. Her kindness and sincerity is a credit to the health service offered in Aberdeen. And there is a lot more stories like this across the North East. We can all be rightly proud of the care NHS Scotland staff deliver day in and day out. This is why NHS staff have public support. The reason why this government has public support, it is because this government has a vision for our nation's public services, protecting funding for the NHS, stopping privatisation and integrating health and social care services. There is no support for a full-scale Labour review in this chamber, just like there is no support for the Labour Party outside it. Presiding officer.
Thank you. I now call on Nanette Millen in closing speeches. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. I think it's fair to say this has been an interesting and probably a worthwhile debate, if at times focusing on the negative rather than the positive. Of course, there are problems in the NHS. We just need to look at recent reports on the Vale of Leven and NHS Grampian to realise that. But there always have been, and I'm sure there always will be. Nonetheless, the fact that our NHS has evolved and grown in the 66 years of its existence into the vast and complex organisation we know today is testament to the many generations of staff and politicians who have been committed to it, as all of us are who are here in the chamber today. The current pressures in the NHS are indeed proof of its success, which has resulted in our burgeoning elderly population living with multiple and complex long-term conditions and the health consequences of old age, like dementia and many of the cancers which stretch its resources to the limit. One of the last things I heard Alec Neil say in this chamber in his role as Health Secretary was that the first person who will reach the age of 150 has already been born. Quite a thought, and a clear indication that pressures on the NHS will continue well into the future. There are huge problems facing us today in staffing levels, both in health and social care, in the management and maintenance of the NHS estate, and not least in dealing with the health inequalities, which are still a blight on many lives in Scotland. Moreover, the NHS and councils will have to deal with many more people as life expectancy increases further. Neil Findlay was his usual fiery self, always pessimistic and always on the attack. I look forward to seeing his optimistic side should he become leader of his party in Scotland later this month. I think the Cabinet Secretary made a fair representation of her government's position, and I wish her well in her new, undoubtedly challenging role.
Neil Findlay.
She must know that if you're a socialist, you're an optimist. The two things go hand in hand, so I'm always optimistic.
I have never found that to be the case, I have to say. As I said in my opening speech, on this side of the chamber, we're willing to work with her and give her our support whenever we can, and I hope she will accept our offer in the spirit in which it's intended. The SNP speakers all made predictable speeches in support of government policy and attacking their number one political enemy. And Labour likewise highlighted every problem which could be used to attack the SNP, although Rhoda Grant did emphasise significant issues about the provision of care in the community, which will no doubt be a key concern of the integration bodies at locality level. I personally think it's wrong to use the NHS as a political football in this way, and it does nothing to help the patients who depend on it. So to conclude, presiding officer, as I've already acknowledged, there are major problems to deal with in NHS Scotland, but I don't think we should despair. We're a resilient nation. We've survived and defeated adversity over many centuries. and we've evolved into a country we can all be proud of. With appropriate leadership from government of whatever political persuasion, and by working together in the interests of patients, I'm confident we can overcome our current problems and achieve a Scottish health service which will be sustainable far into the future, no doubt facing and overcoming even more challenges which are not yet on the horizon. But please, let us indeed work together to improve the health and well-being of our fellow Scots and cut out the political point scoring which makes us so unpopular with the public we serve. They put us where we are, and they deserve our support. So let's try to live up to and beyond their expectations. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Maureen Watt. 6 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've listened very closely to this debate, and first of all, would like to start off by picking up a number of points raised. I mean, Neil Findlay, Rhoda Grant and Lewis MacDonald would love to have us believe that the NHS is a failing basket case in Scotland, and it is not. It does all NHS staff know, it does them a disservice by saying so. You can't on one side praise the staff and then on the other side say it's failing. They can't be both at the same time. The resource budget in real terms is increasing. But where is the extra money that Rhoda Grant and others have asked for coming from? Rhoda Grant, just hold on a minute, said that NHS consequentials would not go to the NHS. And you also said that hospitals are dangerous places. Can I point out that HIE infection is down and cleanliness is up in this government's watch?
Rhoda Grant.
A point of clarification. The Minister has, like her colleague, has misrepresented my position. Health happens within the community. It is underfunded. You need to fund it. And also, our concerns are not made up by ourselves. It is the staff that are working in the NHS that are telling us the NHS has never been like that. That is why the RCN are calling for a root and branch review alongside us.
Maureen Watt.
Yeah, I think the official report will show what Rhoda Grant said about NHS consequentials. And I have asked again and again, and you've still not said, Rhoda Grant or the Labour benches have still not said where the money is coming from. And also, Neil Findlay mentioned delayed discharge. Can I point out that in October 2006, there were 908 patients delayed for over 4 weeks. Today, in October 2014, the number of patients delayed was 321, about one-third of what it was in those... No, thank you. I would like... Well, when you go.
Neil Findlay.
2011. The First Minister said, I have made improved care for the elderly a personal priority. The NHS and local authorities need to work together to ensure that fewer and fewer older people are left languishing in hospital unnecessarily. At that point, 200,000 people were suffering from delayed discharge. Now we have 400,000. Is that a success for the First Minister?
Those figures are not the case, as the member well knows. That is the up-to-date figures on delayed discharges are as I said. But that is why we are integrating health and social care, and the budgets are moving with them. Just yesterday, I had a meeting on community planning partnerships dealing with just this sort of thing. So we're not denying that there are challenges facing the NHS, but this government has a clear sense of vision and direction for working for our NHS and working with our NHS boards. We're putting in place a range of actions to support the delivery of our vision. And I think that was highlighted by the constructive contribution that Nanette Mill and others made. And those who are on the Health Committee know exactly the position on the front line and were constructive enough to point that out. Scotland is also leading the world through our Scottish Patient Safety Programme and the Person-Centred Collaborative, which are improving the quality of care received by patients. We're also focusing our efforts on ensuring that the right people are available to deliver the right care in the right place at the right time. And we need to make better use of workforce intelligence to support medical workforce planning within a more integrated health care system. The partnership approach we take with NHS employers and staff can be extended if they would like to opposition members. For example, our plans for health and social care integration will help to address the challenges of delayed discharge. But I hope the opposition will agree to address this in a cross-party way, as Nanette Milne indicated. And it is something that we can take forward at future cross-party meetings, as the Cabinet Secretary said. And I'm happy to take on ideas from Neil Findlay and others on how we could do things differently and how they can be done within the current financial settlement. But I haven't heard anything about that today. And it's no point in putting the NHS on pause while a review is carried out. But we're happy to meet opposition members to talk about delayed discharge and winter resilience in the coming weeks. We're supporting delivery of high-quality care with significant financial investment. In addition to the investment in the resource budget, we're committed to investment in NHS capital and infrastructure, which will provide the people of Scotland with world-leading hospitals such as the new South Glasgow Hospitals project, which will be completed in 2015. We'll also deliver on the Royal Hospital for Sick Children in Edinburgh, replacement for Dumfries and Galloway Royal Hospital, and a new maternity hospital and cancer centre in Aberdeen. We're developing much better, much more robust intelligence on medical staff profiling and career choices to better inform supply. And we're working with boards to boost the sustainability of the Scottish workforce. Presiding officer, yes, the NHS faces challenge, but we're meeting and dealing with these challenges on a daily basis. And for all these reasons, I urge the Chamber to reject the Labour motion and support the amendment in the name of Fiona Robinson.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Dr. Richard Simpson to wind up the debate. Dr. Simpson, you have until 5 p.m.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
5:30.
Sorry?
5:30.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be summing up in this debate. Regrettably, since 2007, there have only been a tiny number of health debates initiated by the government. And I do believe that the short debate we've been able to have today is wholly inadequate to explore the really major issues that I think the whole Chamber agree health and social care are facing for the future. The SNP came into government in 2007 on a false prospectus. They encouraged the electorate to think at that time, 27, the first time in government. The SNP manifesto committed their government not to close any acute beds. Of course, the reality is that they have had to close a number of acute beds. The reality is also that the services need to be redesigned, but they encouraged the electorate to think that the best way to do this was to maintain every local service and keep every local hospital open. They rejected the Kerr report, and it is clear that although the Scottish collaborative and cooperative model to which we'd all signed up, based on managed care networks, is delivering, but this does require further specialisation. The public sector model, which, as I say, all five parties, including the Conservatives, are signed up to, is radically different from the path being followed by the English NHS. And the most recent report, as some of the SNP members have said, shows that Scotland has indeed narrowed the gap in terms of waiting times. Long gone are the years before 1997, when patients could be waiting for years for hip operations and other procedures. Labour will praise and welcome government initiatives when they do the right thing. For example, as in the case of the proposed major trauma units which have been announced. However, this does come some years after they were introduced and proven to be workable in other jurisdictions. This was also the case with the Health Environment Inspectorate, which we welcomed, but came in 2 years after England had introduced the same inspectorate. Yes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I just remind Richard Simpson that the announcement on the Healthcare Environment Inspectorate was made a year after we came in post? Does it not beg the question what had happened the previous 8 years?
Dr. Simpson.
In the previous 8 years, as you praised, we set up the HAI Task Force. You developed on that, but you were still later by 2 years in setting it up than in England. And this was the case also with the waiting time scandal, where it took 9 months for the SNP to take over the matter and institute a national inquiry. This is currently the case in terms of boarding out, where after pressure from Labour, the government quite rightly introduced a system where boards are required to monitor boarding out. Yet 3 years after that started, we're still unable to get information on boarding out from the boards, as in an FOI we've done recently. And bad boarding out practices abound, as we've seen this week in the HIS report. Again, under pressure, the government agreed finally to set up an inspection scheme with HIS for the elderly. Excellent. Well done. Fantastic. But the Scottish Labour has done an FOI which shows there is absolutely no cross-referencing between boarding out and cognitive impairment. So your systems are actually dysfunctional. Now, whilst the SNP constantly acknowledge, quite rightly, and use the word either pressure or challenges, it is true that the NHS has always faced these challenges. But never in my experience, has there been a situation in which the chairman of the BMA, to which I should declare I belong, Brian Keithley, called it a slow car crash over the last 5 years and went on to apologise for the fact that he felt that he was looking at a situation where it was simply rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. Now the Royal College of Nursing has added their weight to our call for a root and branch review, along with the programme that's been run by the Herald. This is not just Labour. This is many groups are saying, if we're going to have a vision of where we're going to be beyond 2020, then OK, we need to do the same work, on we go. We need to do that work. We need to review what's happening now. We need to do service design just now. But we also need to try and come to an agreed decision beyond 2020. We've agreed to the general principles of 2020, but we need to have a consensus around how we're going to shape our health and social care, not simply say it's going to be integrated. I'm sorry, I don't have time to take an intervention. We need an independent inspection agency, but not one which can actually go in itself and do inspections. It actually has to be ordered by the government to go in, as it was in the case of Grampian, quite rightly. Praise you for doing it. But nevertheless, they had to be authorised and told to do it by the government. The HIS should be able to inspect every group, every aspect of the health service, independently, robustly, and, as you've now finally agreed on HEI, have enforcement powers, as they've had in England for 7 years. So we need to have that. No, I won't. I don't have time. I'm sorry. Now, Jim Hume, I think, made some very valuable points. The Institute for Fiscal Studies showed that Scotland had cut its expenditure against an increase in England between 2010 and 2013. No, I'm sorry, I don't have time. But the point is this. Let's look at these pressures. When every board is failing on a legal guarantee that you chose to give, this is not just a guarantee which we would like to aspire to, which is fine, and where if you fail, well, that's a pity, but it is not a legal guarantee. There are this year over 10,000 Scots who have been given by your government a legal guarantee for the 12-week inpatient and day case who are not having that legal guarantee met. I'm really surprised someone hasn't asked for a judicial review or taken out a case against you in government. But there are also 125,000 Scots this year that will not have their 18-week referral to treatment guarantee met. It will be breached. And that doesn't include a further 100,000 about which we have no information. So the figure could be 250,000. And Jim Hume, I know, was going to mention, if he had time, about CALMS and the fact that 200 young people every month have not had the 26-week guarantee met, and we've got an 18-week guarantee coming up that's going to have problems. And what about the cancer guarantees? There are hundreds of patients who are not getting their cancer guarantee met, and we aren't at the 95% target.
Excuse me, Dr. Simpson. Excuse
of course,
me.
Progress...
Excuse me, there's far, far too much noise in the chamber, Dr. Simpson.
Of course progress has been made. You would expect progress to be made. If it had not been made, we wouldn't have been not criticising you. We would have been criticising you far harder. Everybody would have been criticising you. But you inherited double the money from the Labour. We instituted the biggest increases in health budget that had ever been seen by the health service, and you inherited that. You were lucky.
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
We've learned today that Labour will have refused to give a commitment to a real terms increase and indeed refused to pass on the consequentials to health. Can Richard Simpson confirm both of these things?
Well, we will see. But they...
we
will see. We will see. We will see. But you have constantly repeated the lie that we would not have protected health. We would. It was in our manifesto. And it was in our manifesto, Mr. Swinney. And in addition to that, we have talked repeatedly about the fact that if you do not protect social care, the health service cannot cope. And that is the actual situation. Now, let's look in the last few seconds about the numbers of things that you've done. You plan to cut the junior doctors by 20%. You plan to cut the senior training grades by 40%. You did cut the nursing student intake by 20%. You did cut the midwifery student intake by 40%. And these will have consequences in future years. You failed to listen to us on the junior doctors' rotas until very recently, when Alex Neil announced he would stop the 100 hours night duty over 7 days. But junior doctors are still doing 65 hours over 5 days. And then our FOI has shown that not a single human resources department in the NHS is proactively asking the junior doctors if tiredness is affecting their work
and their ability to journey home.
There are failings here which need seriously to be addressed. We need a root and branch of review. We need an independent inspection system with enforcement powers that is truly independent and doesn't need the government to authorise it to go in. We need change now.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the state of the NHS. We now move to the next item of business. Mr. Findlay.
Presiding Officer, on the 21st of October 2011, the then Cabinet Secretary, Nicola Sturgeon, said, "I have made improved care for the elderly a personal priority. The NHS and local authorities need to work together to ensure that fewer and fewer people are left languishing in hospital unnecessarily." During today's debate, I referred to this and the fact that at that time, 200,000 bed days were lost to delayed discharge in the NHS. Today, that figure is over 400,000 bed days. When I raised this issue in debate, Maureen Watt, the Minister, accused me of misleading Parliament by saying the figures were wrong. I wonder if you will allow her tomorrow at some point to come back to Parliament to correct the record.
Can I say, Mr. Findlay, that is not a point of order. I have said repeatedly in this chamber that what members say in this chamber are a matter for them and them alone. This minister is sitting listening to you. If the minister indicates she wishes to speak tomorrow, then I would give her the time to do so, but she's making no indication that she wishes to. So we now move to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 11769, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 11769.
Formally moved.
Thank you. No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 11769, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of 6 Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions number 11770 to 11773 on approval of SSIs en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
And motion number 11774 on committee membership, and motion number 11775 on substitution on committees.
Moved.
The questions on these motions will come at decision time, to which we now come. There are 9 questions to be put as a result of today's business. Can I remind members that in relation to the debate on private sector rent reform, if the amendment in the name of Margaret Burgess is agreed, the amendment in the name of Alex Johnson falls. The first question then is amendment number 11763.3 in the name of Margaret Burgess, which seeks to amend motion number 11763 in the name of Mary Fee on private sector rent reform be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. the result of the vote on amendment number 11763.3 in the name of Margaret Burgess is as follows. Yes, 64. No, 53. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Alex Johnson falls. The next question is that motion number 11763 in the name of Mary Fee as amended on private sector rent reform be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 11763 in the name of Mary Fee as amended is as follows. Yes, 64. No, 53. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. Can I remind members that in relation to the debate on the state of the NHS, if the amendment in the name of Shona Robison is agreed, the amendment in the name of Nanette Milne falls. The next question then is amendment number 11766.3 in the name of Shona Robison, which seeks to amend motion number 11766 in the name of Neil Findlay on the state of the NHS be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 11766.3 in the name of Shona Robison is as follows. Yes, 65. No, 38. There were 13 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Nanette Milne falls. The next question is that amendment number... The next question is that motion number 11766 in the name of Neil Findlay as amended on the state of the NHS be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 11766 in the name of Neil Findlay as amended is as follows. Yes, 67. No, 37. There were 13 abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. I propose to ask a single question on motion numbers 11770 in 21773 on approval of SSIs. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. Nobody objects. So the next question is that motion number 11770 to 11773 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of SSIs be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 11774 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on committee membership be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 11775 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on substitution on committees be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.